If you are like me, you really struggle with temptation sometimes. Satan can just come and beat us up with temptation. And so many of us, we end up falling into a temptation and we feel guilt and we feel shame and we really struggle in our faith. And so what I want to do today is I just want to share with you a great passage of scripture on James chapter 1, where James describes to us the process of how Satan tempts us. Because if we understand the process, we're going to be able to use some tools to overcome temptation and to beat Satan at his own game. And so I just want to take you through, just for a few minutes here, some scriptures that I think you will really enjoy. I'm going to begin in James chapter 1, verse 12, where he says, "Blessed is the man who perseveres under trial, because when he has stood the test, he will receive the crown of life that God has promised to those who love him. When tempted, however, no one should say, 'God is tempting me,' for God cannot be tempted by evil, nor does he tempt anyone." So the first thing James does is he gives us a difference between a trial and a temptation. Okay, a trial can come from God. It can come from Satan. Trials are more external, things going on around us more than internal, what's going on in our heart, although that's not always the case. But trials are set up for a win. He tests us. God tests us, or he tries us so that he can build our faith, so he can authenticate our faith, so he can grow us in our faith. And so trials are just a part of life. They're not temptations. He says when we respond to them with perseverance and we win those, it is great for our faith, and it builds this wonderful, wonderful, not only in heaven, but here on earth, foundation for our faith and our walk with Jesus Christ. And so that's trials. But temptations are different. God cannot tempt, nor can he be tempted. You see what James said there? God cannot tempt. So when we are tempted, it is clearly not God. It is Satan doing the temptation. Now, why do I bring that up? Because one of Satan's tools when he tempts us is he tries to blame it on God. And so he will tempt us, we'll fall, and then we'll get mad at God for our falling. Well, God does not tempt. So this is not about God. It is about what Satan is doing in the temptation process. Okay? So I want to make that very clear from the very beginning. So he says this, "Each one is tempted when by his own evil desire he is dragged away and enticed. Then after the desire has conceived, it gives birth to sin, and sin, when it is full grown, gives birth to death. Therefore, brothers, do not be deceived." So he compares the process of temptation and sin to what? The process of insemination and childbirth, right? Which is very, very interesting that he would use that as an example. But notice at the very end, he says what? Don't be deceived. Why does he say that? Because temptation by the enemy happens right up here. Satan is a master liar. He is the deceiver. Jesus is the truth. And so the battle is in my mind between truth and lies. Jesus is telling me truth. Satan is telling me lies. But here's the key. Satan tells lies and he dresses them up with half-truths that make them sound very logical and very good if you don't know the Word well, if you don't know God well. And so Satan really disguises himself and works very, very hard to make sure that he can deceive us. And so the best thing I can do for my temptation is what? Know the truth. Get in the Word. So it's very, very important part of the overall process of temptation is getting in the Word and knowing the truth. So when the deception comes, I recognize it, I know it, and I can address it for what it is. If you don't do that, if you're not in the Word, if you're not learning truth, Satan will use half-truth against you, and you'll end up finding yourself in a situation that is very, very difficult. So let's move on from there to what he says. Now listen to this process. Each one is tempted when by his own evil desire. I want to talk to you a little bit about that phrase, own evil desire. Now, you know that we are created in the image of God. We have the image of God in us. However, when Adam sinned, we all inherited what Paul calls in Romans chapter 5 a sin nature. It's also called the flesh. And our sin nature in us, we just like to sin. We like fleshly things. We are drawn to the things of the world, and Satan knows that. And you know what? God knows that too. That's part of living in a fallen world, is we have a fallen heart, and our heart is easily given over to temptation, and we have to understand that. And James here calls it evil desires. And I don't want you to miss this. I want you to get it. We all have evil desires. Don't sit there and think that your heart isn't capable of hatred. Don't think that your heart isn't capable of greed and jealousy and lust and all sorts of other evil desires. That is a part of us. And James says temptation happens in that part of our heart, in that place in our heart. So if we're going to address temptation, what do? We have to address that part of our heart where our evil desires lay. It's in that old evil nature. It's that sinful nature. It's the flesh. Emotions are not the flesh and the evil nature. However, a lot of the sinful nature is wrapped around emotions. And so the most vulnerable part of ourselves, when you think about our mind, our will, and our emotions, the most vulnerable part is our emotions. And when you think about secular people and you think about people that don't have a God or a conscience at all, what always leads their decision-making processes? Their emotions. I'm not happy, therefore I'm going to do this. I feel sad, therefore I'm going to do this. I feel jealous, therefore I'm going to do this. They let their emotions dictate their thought processes and their actions. And I'm telling you, when the emotions do that, it's a train wreck. It's a train wreck. So what God says is, what I want you to do is understand that your emotions aren't bad. In fact, let me give you an illustration of what your emotions are. Your emotions are like warning lights on your vehicle. Okay, think about the gas tank. Okay, when the warning light comes on, that gauge on your dashboard of your vehicle, what's it telling you? You need to fill up with gas. It's a warning light. That's what your emotions are. I'm sad. Ding, 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 that's a warning light that I could be open to temptation. I'm angry. Ding, 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 that's a warning light that if I'm not careful, I could sin in my anger and do some very destructive thing to the relationships that I love. So emotions aren't bad. Emotions actually form a very good purpose and function in who we are as whole human beings. But they just can't drive the car. They're not the engine, they're not the transmission, and they're not the drivetrain. They're the gauges on the dashboard. They tell me how I should be responding in my vehicle. So emotions are important, but they need to sit in the back seat. They don't need to drive the car. They need to sit on the dashboard and warn us, but they don't need to be the drivetrain. What for a Christian is the drivetrain? What is the engine is what? Our character. Our character. So I want you to think it this way. If you don't have the Holy Spirit of God and you're not walking in your faith, your emotions dictate your thoughts, which dictate your actions. When you're a person of God, you pay attention to the emotions, but you start where? Right up here. This is where it happens. This is where spiritual warfare occurs. I think, and then I act apart from my emotions, but dictated by the warning lights of my emotions. So I don't let my emotions to the front of the car. I put them in the back of the car where they belong. So I hope you understand that process about this whole idea of evil desires. Okay? We all have them, and we have to address them if we're going to overcome temptation. We have to understand Satan's going to try to use our emotions against us, so you have to be careful with your emotions, and he's always going to start with a half-truth, half-lie right up here. Sooner I catch it up here, the better off I am. Okay, so let's continue on here. He says, each one is tempted when his own evil desires. He is dragged away and enticed. That's the other word I want to talk about, enticed. Satan is an enticer. Now, think about it. Satan knows you. He's watched your actions. He sees your propensities to sin. He knows you have a sinful nature. He knows that you have emotions that if you're not careful, you'll let run your life. He knows all that stuff, okay? Satan is a master fisherman. Here's the word picture I want to give you. Think about a fisherman that puts a worm on a hook and he casts it out into a lake or a river, okay? And he's got that bait on that hook. What's he doing? He's trying to get the bait right in front of the fish. And when the bait comes right in front of the fish, what he's hoping is that the fish doesn't recognize the hook, only sees the bait, and bites the bait. And when he bites the bait, the hook is set and you're going to catch your fish. That's what Satan does. He knows your weaknesses. He knows your propensities to sin. He knows the emotions that will sabotage you the easiest. He knows those things. And so he sets bait that appeal to your emotions that you have the hardest time controlling. He sets a bait that appeals to your sinful nature and your sinful desires. And what is temptation for one is not temptation for another. He uniquely sets it for all human beings, and he just dangles it right in front of you all the time. That's why you feel tempted a lot, right? It's just right there. Now, what do we have? We have prayer as a defensive weapon. We can pray that God lead us not into temptation, right? That we resist temptation. We have the Word of God that we can quote Scripture. And when we quote Scripture, Satan has to go away. Isn't that what Jesus did when he was tempted? He quoted Scripture and Satan left till a more opportune time, is what Matthew chapter 4 says. So we have tools at our disposal that God has given us to win this battle. We have friends that can help us, that we can talk to about it. But when it comes to understanding the process, what do we know? Satan's always throwing that bait right in front of us. What's our job? To recognize when there's a hook behind the bait. Because that's Satan at work. That's the enticement. That's the part where we now have a baby. We now have a baby in the womb. It has now grown, and it's going to give birth to sin here pretty soon. And so think about whatever you struggle with the most. Okay, let's say it's money and greed. Okay, Satan's always going to be throwing things, opportunities for you to maybe make bad investments. Or maybe he's going to throw opportunities for you to waste money. Or maybe he's going to throw opportunities out there for you to go into debt. Or maybe he's going to throw opportunities out there for you to buy things you don't need. Right? And he's just constantly putting those before you. Well, what do? Well, you walk in truth. And you know what God's plan for you is with regarding your money. And you know you have a greedy nature. You know that's part of your sin nature. And you pray about that. And you ask the Holy Spirit to lead you in that area. And you talk to friends about that and confess that and say, this is a struggle for me. I need you guys to help me walk this out. And you are aware that what Satan is going to do is he's always going to throw those right in front of you. So what are you going to do when they come in front of you? You got to check to see if there's a hook behind it. Maybe it's an authentic possibility. Maybe it's something authentic that you need to buy, but it might be a temptation. So what do? It's won or lost right up here, right? So you look at truth of Scripture. You seek the Lord out in prayer to see if this is an authentic situation you need to walk into, or whether Satan's trying to bait you because he knows you have that propensity towards sin. It's true with lust. It's true with greed. It's true with pride. It's true with anger. It's true with a whole lot of other things. Okay, he can use those things against you. We have to see. We have to be ready with our eyes, ready with our ears, ready with our thoughts to see if there's a hook behind it, because he's going to try to entice us. And if he can entice us, then what does he say? It gives birth to sin. See, when we take the hook, that's where he's got us. Always remember this. The temptation is not the sin. The temptation is not the sin. Sometimes I'll have guys that are struggling with lust, and they'll say, man, I was walking down the street, and I just saw this beautiful woman, and she had a low-cut dress on, and man, there were her breasts just right there in front of me. That's the temptation. That's not the sin. That was just the hook. What'd you do with that glance? You saw it. Did you look away? Did you stare? Did you think about it all day? Did you lust after her? Did you play a scenario in your head? That's all temptation leading into sin. But that coming right before you, that was the temptation. But it was not the sin. The sin is what you do with it. So don't confuse temptation and sin, because Satan will want to shame you with the temptation when the temptation is not the sin. Just know, what do you have? Your godly friends, truth of the Word of God, prayer to walk you through that. Okay, so it is very important to understand this process. So what is it? Don't be deceived, right? Because it's all happening right up here. Immerse yourself in truth and watch what you watch. Number two, understand you have a sinful nature and that you have propensities towards sin. And what's Satan going to try to use? Your emotions against you. Watch your emotions and don't let your emotions lead you into temptation. Number three, he's going to try to entice you. He's going to bait you with a hook. So what do? You have to always be looking back to truth to make sure that there's not a hook with that bait. You have to make sure. Because if he hooks you, then he's got you. And what happens when he hooks you? It's very simply this. You repent. You just come back before the Lord and say, Lord, I'm so sorry. I confess my sin to you. I repent. Lord, teach me the lesson I need to learn so I don't go back down that road again. Purify my mind, purify my heart, and lead me not into temptation, but deliver me from the evil one. So that's what you do in that process. And so I want to close out with just an illustration for you to think about. I tell people in my ministry that I used to say that you can't let temptation get to flesh, because if you let it get to flesh, you lose every time, and that's true. But I'm going to go one step further and say you can't let temptation get to fantasy, because if you fantasize about something, you will rationalize doing it. So let me just give you a real easy example, okay? Let's just suppose for a minute you're a salesperson, and your boss comes in to you and says, tomorrow morning, I've got a sales presentation I want you to make, and when you make this sales presentation, it's going to be the biggest sale you ever make in your life, and your commission on this sale is going to be $250,000, $250,000. But here's the key. Right there in point B, number one, that's a real sticking point for him. I need you to overlook that. Make sure he doesn't ask about that. And if he does, just deceive him. We can't let him go to that place or we're going to lose this sale. So immediately, what's your response? Can't do that. That's unethical. I won't do it, right? That's all of our response. We can't do it. So he says, no. Go home and think about it. You can't tell me no yet. In the morning at 9:55, you can tell me no. And if so, I'm going to walk in at 10 and I'm going to make the sale and I'm going to keep the $250,000. I'm just doing this as a favor for your family. So you let me know in the morning at 10. So you go home and what do? See, Satan's hooked you, right? He's baited you. He's got the bait right in front of you. When you let it get to fantasy and you start fantasizing about everything you're going to do with that money, well, I'm going to tithe the first 10% to the Lord. You know what? I'm going to double tithe and I'm going to give 25% to the poor. And you know what? This could help with my kids' college fund. And you know what? This could pay off all my debt so I could be more attentive to the Holy Spirit to giving. By the next day, you've convinced yourself that the holiest thing you could do for the kingdom is lie and make that sale. That's what happens in fantasy. That's why you have to win the battle of temptation right when it first comes in your mind. You can't start fantasizing about outcomes. You have to kill it up front. You have to kill it up front right when it comes in. You have to see the hook, ask for discernment from the Lord, look at truth, and then you don't jump to the hook. You don't begin to fantasize. You fantasize, you lose. The closer, the earlier you can address that issue, the earlier you can walk away and say no, the better you're going to win in your battle for temptation. So there's many things to say about temptation. I'll actually have another teaching out of 1 Corinthians chapter 10 before too long. But I just wanted to share with you these thoughts out of James chapter 1 to help you understand the process of temptation so you can overcome. Let's pray. Father, we want to be overcomers with temptation. We want to win the battle. And so give us, Lord, the truth. Give us your Spirit. Give us prayer. Give us the strength to say no to the evil one and his temptations. In Jesus' name, amen. Thank you very much. Hope you have a blessed day.